Alrighty, I'm here with none other than Richard Garfield, the creator of Magic the Gathering, and Matt Place, who is not only been someone who's worked on Magic and many other games, but is also the lead designer of Storybook Brawl. So, Matt, let's do some chats, shall we?
Oh, wait, but who are you?
Oh.
Or do we all know that?
I wear a few hats, but right now, well, actually, I'm not literally wearing a hat right now, but I work on Storybook Brawl as well. I recently joined the team. I'm really glad you guys have me. So
yeah, we're so excited to have you. We worked together long ago on many different games, and it's super fun that we get to work together again. Yeah, super awesome. Richard, thanks so much for joining us. Yeah, so wanted to kind of ask you, we had a mutual friend who clued you into Storybook Brawl. Wanted to ask you just what's your experience been so far playing the game?
Oh, it's been incredible. It's a really good game. Great game, really. It's in that genre of games that I'm very interested in, auto chess, and it's following the footsteps of Hearthstone's Battlegrounds rather than the more RTS based auto duels. And I find that a really interesting area where I've begun thinking about them as chaos engines.
Yeah.
And it's like if you set the chaos engine upright, you can kind of see where it's going and you kind of feel like you got control, but it can spin off the rails. That feels to me what the game's about. So it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's funny as you describe that. It does make me think of Robo Rally, right? Where I'm like, okay, here's my plan. Can it spin off the wheel? Yeah. Can it spin off the conveyor belt? Absolutely, it does every time, but super fun still. Yeah, TFT and Underlords, a lot of us were playing and loving, right? Had a ton of fun. But I think our time there was limited partly because it was so hard to figure out, how do I get better? What is actually happening? Why am I winning and losing? And being somebody who, you know, really gets into games, it made it a little tough for me to just feel permanently confused in those games. Love Battlegrounds just being much clearer, still being chaos.
Right. Yeah. I had the same experience. I really enjoyed the previous games and thought that it was a rich new area, and yeah. Thought that Battlegrounds really put their finger on what was missing for me. Yes. I loved being able to follow what was going on at the pace they were going, and one of my favorite experiences in Storybook Brawl is when you have the game, you have the battle locked up and you can see it's locked up, but then your mind jumps to this weird corner case that might happen. Right. And all these things have to happen in order for it to fail. Right. And you see it just go one after the other. It's like, oh my gosh, how did I lose? I suppose yes. It's even better when it works the other way, since it
right,
does
yeah.
that too.
Oh, yeah. How can I win?
Skipping them is by far right. the best.
Couldn't my Medusa actually kill all three of their back row? You know?
Yeah.
And it can happen. And that actually speaks to a lot of why I think the game, both the fun and replayability are there, right? Is the, at least you've talked about this, kind of the sweat, right? The, okay, here we go. I think I have a sense of the battle's just beginning. I think I have a sense of how I'm doing relative to my opponent, but there's tons that I'm still like, okay, I want to get that plus one gold from Kitty Cut Purse, or will I actually trigger this, that, and the other, right? Yeah,
well, the number of other things going yeah. on at it is during the battle is there's so many things in general to hope for or hope doesn't happen.
Is your prize going to survive?
Yeah.
Right.
Are you going to get hit extra times for the plus one damage
right.
from the level three tree folk?
Yeah, one of the things that I really noticed in contrast to Battlegrounds, also a huge fan of Battlegrounds over here. I played a ton of Hearthstone Battlegrounds.
Mike Renee. Yeah.
Yeah. Is there's a lot of times in Battlegrounds where you don't really pay attention to all that engaged during the fight, because you're either going to win or you're going to lose. But like what happens in the fight doesn't matter insofar as the end result is what you care about. In fact, a lot of folks actually, not a lot, but enough of the folks use like the extension where you actually just like X out during the fight and reconnect to get more shopping time.
Oh yeah.
And that's something really? I've seen people do.
Oh, I haven't heard of that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a pretty try hard thing. I don't do it, 'cause that's just not fun for me, but it's something people do. And it really speaks though to one of the differences is that in Storybook Brawl, because of Slay, because of quests, because of, well, Prize Pig, which I can never not buy, you not only care about the result of the fight, you care about what happens within the fight, to the point where I think we've all had fights where we've lost but felt like we won the fight. Our adventurer got two slaves.
Oh, absolutely.
Incredible.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, I hate getting the prize pig and then feeling compelled to stick him in the front row.
Right.
It's like, oh.
Or so buying him and five rounds later, you're like, well, that's plus five gold for five different opponents.
Exactly. I've got to get rid of this pig. It's killing me.
Yeah. And that speaks to something that's like, it's tough, right? Because the randomness is quite high in the game, while also the skill is quite high.
Yeah. Right?
Which is what we were going to preach about.
Yeah. I love high skill, high randomness games. A certain group of gamers, they want to control the randomness and believe that that maximizes the skill. And, you know, sometimes it does increase the skill, but it also sweeps under the rug all these really wonderful areas of skill, which is sort of maximizing your percentages and taking advantage of opportunities and minimizing the problems that arise that you didn't expect. It's a really great area of game.
Yeah, I remember attending your talk with Justin Gary on this topic. Super interesting, yeah. And how much more skill there can be and how much more to discover randomness and confusion, right? Complex systems create versus tic-tac-toe. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You've got to, if you can get your experts to be happy with winning, you know, 80% of the time rather than 99.999% of the time, that's a great place for the game to be.
It's also 100. Better for your experts because they will soon run out of opponents if they win every game.
Yeah, absolutely.
And run out of fun. 99.9% is too boring, honestly, right?
Yeah. That number certainly isn't thrown around lightly also. It's like there are some games that's you really, if I go up against a top level StarCraft player, yeah, what are my chances of winning? Not very high. But there's, you know, a lot of skill in Storybook Brawl, and I at least fantasize that I could win against top players here. And even if it's only, you know, 10%, 20% of the time, or my share, not the time.
It's also a much better analog to life because, you know, a lot of the things that we love about games is how much it teaches us about life. There's basically no aspect of life you can completely control. So learning how to deal with randomness, just putting yourself in the best chance possible where, yeah, maybe you change your oil enough so your car doesn't break down, but sometimes it's going to break down and you're going to get unlucky. And kind of mentally dealing with that is something that a lot of people have trouble with. How many people do you know that just like rage when they get a flat tire? Because yeah, it sucks. But if you're used to the mindset of I put myself in the best position, sometimes bad things happen, a lot easier to kind of shrug those things off.
No, that's a great attitude, and certainly philosophically the way I look at it. But it also allows you to get some understanding for people who do strive for games at the other end, because they are looking for something that they can control. And that's so rare in life. But you know, I'm really happy embracing the randomness myself. So
yes, same, agreed. And that's kind of, you know, why card games are so popular, right? All the different types of card games, right? Because they have a lot of that. It's funny, you know, the way we're describing it also describes a lot of magic, right? The chance to win, the randomness, how do you deal with what might happen? And we were talking about this earlier, speaking of magic, where we're at right now, we're in the very early days, right? 10 weeks in, basically, with Storybook Brawl, believe it or not, which is crazy. And one of the things we're looking at is how do we get bigger, right? And it reminds me of some of the stories, like how do we get the word out there? How do we get everybody to try out the game? We're doing pretty well in like a tight community of Magic and Hearthstone, but eventually we want to get the phone version out, right? We want to get all these things that'll attract a lot more people, improve the visuals, et cetera, et cetera. And it reminds me of some of the stories. I wanted to ask you about this, Richard. Some of the stories I heard of the early day Magic, one of the marketing campaigns was a van that drove around from comic book store to comic book store, teaching the owners to play Magic as a way to start the momentum. Is that true?
That is true. But that happened actually before the game was released.
Oh, okay.
Once it was released, there was no need for that. It was just crazy. How
Gen Con, right?
Marketing it. Marketing it would have been for the first couple years was almost working against us because you just couldn't provide what was already demanded. But wow. Yeah, leading up to that, Peter Adkisson, the president of Wizards, took a van across the country and played it with all these different small game shop owners and comic book store owners, and you know, who knows, that certainly may have given it a boost up in that initial launch.
Right, how much of it? Yeah. We should we get a van, Luis?
Yeah, I think so. I think that's a good plan.
A van and an iPad. Yeah, that's awesome. And so marketing is a big thing for us. And then another thing that we talked a little bit about this with you, Richard, is just kind of our plan for the future in terms of content. So one of the things we want to do is, you know, figure out how do we keep the game fresh? How do we make sure that the puzzles and the, you know, ooh, what you're thinking about, what you're trying to accomplish, keep being fun for a long time, which is, once again, clearly achieved in Magic the Gathering. Here we are so many years later, still loving it. So one of the things we want to do is introduce new heroes. And part of our thinking there is that a hero, especially with a cool, unique power, can change the value of all the characters you're drafting.
Yeah.
Right. And so the puzzles kind of become new, even with the same game pieces, is part of what we're going for.
Yeah. It's very, very sensible. As I've told you before, I just think he did a great job in this initial set of heroes in the variety and how much, like, they're not just now I'm going for these cards, and now I'm going for those cards. It's much more. Some of them are reasonably straightforward in that way, but most of them have. There's just a lot of subtlety to how they play differently. Some of them are just totally wacky. And so it seems like you're heading down a good path with that, because your team certainly has the talent to design very interesting heroes.
Awesome. Thank you. Yeah.
I think there's more design space. I think we can make more heroes. Yeah. If that was the question. Yeah.
Well, also, I imagine whether it's whether it's motivating and I think so. I think that's very exciting. I mean, cards, of course, are. Like, as we're playing, I just keep on thinking of all these new cards that could be added. Think of sending off ideas to you. Like,
oh yes,
files and files of these.
Oh, sure. Please. But, yeah, that'd be great.
you've sort of done what I love to do in initial releases of games, which is staked out all these different possible areas without fleshing out all the things in between, so that the player plays and they can imagine like how much design space is there. It just feels very large.
Cool. That's awesome. Yeah. This makes me think of, you know, when you joke, Luis, about are there more heroes or space? The early days of Magic, I remember people wondering about that, like internally at Wizards. Like, yeah. Hey, when do we run out?
Yeah. That was, I mean, I took that seriously. I figured that, well, first of all, at the very beginning, I thought that Wizards should be in the business of selling card game environments, not cards, because you can make effectively infinite numbers of environments, whereas there's only a finite number of cards. Turns out that finite number is very, very large. Right. But in trying to keep the amount of text on the cards small and so forth, that's the pressure I felt like I was up against. But you've got the same sort of thing here, where even if there is a limited number of cards, which I think effectively there isn't, you change, you know, one of them and you've got a different game.
Yeah, we actually have a balance change coming that we're just need to test a bit more, but basically all the decisions are done. That it's interesting, just what is it, 5 cards, Luis, we're changing balance wise, how much it changes the experience, right? Now do I go for Prince and Princess more? Won't spoil it here, but now do I go for Princess more earlier, right? How much does it change my evaluations? And when you mention environment, you mean like what set of cards are available changes the feel, right?
Right.
I really like what Mike and the team did for Battlegrounds with that, right? They have the tribes. It's a smart way to do it. The other games have tried to do that as well. Sometimes they just reset their entire environment. But I really like that path. We're figuring out, we're still talking about it because we aren't to that point yet where we need to, is where we feel. But eventually someday, I think we're going to really look at that as a smart kind of guiding light.
No, I think it's wise to be cautious in that direction, just because I think there's a tendency to want to change things too quickly.
Sure.
And that makes it so that players don't they don't have enough time to explore what's there, and they don't feel like they've got enough time to master it before sort of the rug's pulled. And that can be really detrimental to the experience. And one of the great things about games, one of my favorite things about great games, is that you can play them infinitely, right? You can still play Scrabble 100 years after it's been created. And I think that's true with a lot of these games. Like, people talk about, how Magic is kept alive by this constant influx of cards. And that is exciting for a lot of players. But the first set of cards was played for years and years, and people still enjoy, if you wanted to draft it, it'd still be fun, right? So you can get a lot of play value, and not only a lot of play value, but the better you know it, the better your experience. It's like it's one of the things why in great games I like to really educate players as much as possible, because I think the more educated you are, the more fun you're going to have.
Okay. Yeah. Interesting.
So Richard, Matt, I have to ask you this, because Matt and I have had this discussion many, many, many times. Would you change anything about Alpha, knowing what you know now?
Not significantly. There are certainly cards I would kill or change, but what might surprise people is that those cards don't include things like Black Lotus and Ancestral Recall.
Right.
They are more things like Raging River and Camouflage, where we haul out the micro font for a card which isn't worth reading about anyway. I'm a big proponent of trying to balance cards for all levels of players, balance games for them rather than just the top level. And so I sort of get tired of playing these games where I play it and it feels like all the fun has been developed out of it. Like everything's so balanced that if you're really, really good, you can still have a game, but otherwise it feels like it really doesn't matter what I do.
Right.
And with the early set of Magic, it actually took a long time for people to be good enough to realize how good Black Lotus was, for example.
Right.
Yeah. I remember I learned how to play in 94 when I was 11, and I remember when I'd heard myths of Black Lotus, and honestly, when I finally found out what it did, I was disappointed, because I was like,
right,
what, Shivan Dragon is so much cooler. What,
right.
Why is this the card that everyone's talking about? I don't get it.
I have the same experience. A buddy of mine traded for Black Lotus and then found out you have to sacrifice it.
Yeah.
Man, and he's like, what?
Just a land is better. You get to keep the land forever.
I mean, there's some formats where a land would probably make you win more if you put a mountain in your deck instead of a Black Lotus.
Oh, yeah. And depending on how you play it, I remember one of the things we did in the early days, which sort of emphasizes the fact that it was balanced well for the players, was I would go to card game stores and I had a deck of all common cards, and people would come up and say, it's like, I'm going to crush you with my, it's like, I got the best deck in town. And they'd have tons of rare cards, but they do things like Black Lotus, Shivan Dragon, and I'd Terror. Right. And then they'd have an empty hand. Right. So it took a long time for people to sort of get to the point where cards like Black Lotus were actually a bad idea. I mean, we're certainly there now, and we were, several years after the game came out. Pro Tour was really where you can start to say, definitely, we had to work to keep up with the players. We had to start hiring players in order to be as good as they were. Before that, the best players in the world were at Wizards.
Yeah. The it's funny, by the way, Richard, speaking of 11-year-old LSV Magic player, our good friend, our mutual friend, Brian Weissman. Actually, what's the story, Luis?
Oh, my God. All right. So I had been a lapsed Magic player. I had stopped playing in high school, actually, because my grades were getting too low because I spent too much time playing Magic. So my parents made me quit. So I go to college and I walk into a game store. I'm like, oh, I haven't played Magic in years. Maybe this will be fun. And I did a draft, and round one, I played against Brian Weissman, And he pile shuffled my deck and is like, you're playing 39 cards and I got a game loss. And then I didn't play Magic for a year after that.
Brian almost got me to quit Magic. That's crazy.
I do have to say this, especially since Brian might watch this. I love Brian. He's an awesome guy. I've had a ton of positive interactions with him. But coming back in, he's just hyper competitive. My first experience being after not playing for 5 years of like, oh, so Magic's like this. Okay, yeah, I don't know if I'm ready for this yet, you know. It turns out I eventually was ready to be very competitive.
Well, that's as much the tournament structures or moderators' fault. You've got to have some level of forgiveness, especially when people are just coming in. I think in most serious games with a serious format, when you're playing with people who are just coming back in or at the casual level or whatever, you know, having even gross issues like that is just like, oh, we'll fix your deck and let's go.
Totally.
Yeah. Funny enough, small world, Mike Donay, as a head judge of Magic, actually helped judges get better at that, right? A lot of the head judges back then around the year 2000 kind of fixed that system where it wasn't as brutal for the new player.
Yeah.
It's a big deal for Magic. Yeah.
It was a surprise. I mean, it was a surprise at one point where I went to some tournaments and saw, you know, some of the more kinder, gentler second generation judges, letting people, you know, sort of correcting people and putting them on the path rather than disciplining them on the spot. This rule book says this, and, you know, trying to keep up with the spirit of what you're trying to do rather than.
Even at the highest levels now, the penalties have been drastically reduced because for the most part, people aren't trying to get an edge by presenting a 39 card deck. They're, you know, and you know, someone forgets to de-sideboard and draws a sideboard card in game one. You no longer are getting these like draconian penalties because ultimately your goal is to play Magic, and these penalties aren't really like in the spirit of that. So it's kind of percolated upwards as time has gone on, which I think is awesome.
Yeah. Way better than when I played back in the
90s. Well, we don't need to get into the your tactics because you're a product of your times. Let's just put it that way.
But speaking, you're talking about game balance for what would you change in Alpha and how is Alpha balanced, which is a masterpiece, especially when you look at like sets that would come in the next 2 years, how they're balanced compared to Alpha. Alpha being such a masterpiece is really interesting with the wide range of power levels, right? And a lot of us who love Magic have read some of your interviews where you talk about, you know, well, the rarity and the understanding of the players is a big part of that puzzle, right? And we in Storybook Brawl have kind of a different angle on that same concept, which is, hey, what do you have on turn three? What do you have on turn five? And what can we let you kind of high roll? What can we let you get lucky with? And how does that scale, right? And in the end game, we're like, you know what? The game's going to be over. You're going to start again. So what can we let you do? And so part of our balancing is, hey, let the dream be infinite, right? Like just let anything happen in the end game. It's still balanced because of percentages and did you skillfully get there? What have you thought of that? How we balance this game?
I have not thought much about how to balance Storybook Brawl, but what I've seen of it has been really marvelous. I love sort of how often I'm given things to hope for. And sometimes they're orthogonal. You know, it's like the most common thing, of course, is common to all these games, which is get three of a kind.
Right.
But then you've got all these other things like special spells that can come up or treasures you could, you know, the different options for the treasures you can draw, just huge texture change to the game. The variety is really what keeps me coming back.
I think it's just awesome to see numbers, not every game, because that wouldn't be great, but numbers, you know, like sometimes you have a character that has 10,000 attack. Like the way it scales isn't linear, you know, it's just crazy. It's exponential when you're like, oh, I have my sword plus 100 and my Echo Wood and my good boy, or, you know, things like that, that just like compound to just get you to these highs that you don't see. But as you said, a big key piece of that is when you get there, the game usually ends within a turn or two because you're in the end game. When you face it, you probably face it once and then just die if you haven't gotten your own comp to that level. And I've finished many dozens of lobbies where no one got near that power level. It doesn't happen every time.
Right. That's sort of that's a piece of the puzzle, certainly was at the beginning. It felt like I couldn't win because everybody who went into the end game had crazy combos that I didn't have the skill to get. And now that I know the game a little better, maybe the audience has changed some. Not only have I acquired the skill to get some of those crazy combos, and it's like they're a lot of fun to play. But sometimes I'm going into the end with sort of a modest, solid deck, and I end up winning to my surprise. You know, it's like I expect to be facing something much crazier, and it just doesn't come together. If it doesn't come together every time, that's a good thing.
Yeah, I agree. From a design perspective, right? I think it adds to the fun, right? If it's a given that you're going to have a crazy combo, right?
Right, because then you know halfway through the game, you may as well give up because it's not coming together for you.
Right, yeah. And part of it, what's nice too, is that even if it's not coming together for you, can you still play for second or third, right? You face the guy who high rolled, you can't beat, or at least you're not close to, and you got to get really lucky to beat. But it's kind of nice, just the mentality, I think, of like the free-for-all kind of mini battle royale is, hey, let me see what I can pull out here, right? Even if I can't beat Sad Dracula, he's going to get redesigned, by the way. But has the broken Shadow Assassin.
No, say it isn't true.
sorry.
I think Sad Dracula, I do like a lot. I also like the Trophy Hunter.
That's my favorite.
Open-endedness of, is like looking at this thing as like, well, the fact that it's a last breath, but it's now a sleigh. How can I abuse that? It's just marvelous.
Yeah. Raptor made that one. I love it. It's my favorite hero.
Hard, sometimes surprisingly hard to use. I always love playing him.
Yeah, he's the quintessential, like the combo almost came together and then I had zero health.
Exactly. Yeah. And as you said, one of the really enjoyable things in this is there's enough swinginess to the card draft that no matter what hero you're playing, you have to be open to changing your plan and not playing strongly into their strength or even at all into their strength to do as best you can. And Trophy Heroes is one of those where it's like sometimes I'll end up playing him and, you know, it's like I'm only getting some trophy conversion late in the game, if at all. And I'm still doing okay. I wish I got them earlier, but had to take advantage of the opportunities that were given.
Right. Yeah. Or with Krampus, I'm locking for my third unicorn. And I'm like, I'm not doing this right. I'm just what I'm doing. Awesome. Cool. Well, this is fun. Thanks.
I have to say, you broke me a little last time we chatted because you mentioned prince and princesses weren't doing as well as you wanted, and I talked to some other. I don't know. I think there's something wrong with me that when I hear that, is like that's what I obsess with.
Challenge. Yeah.
So I think that really hurt my ratings. But I'm pretty good at running them now. But it's like I can't pull myself away once something starts to come together along those lines.
Cool. Yeah, we've got two updates coming that should help Prince and Princess. The earlier one is a change to Prince Arthur. And then the latter one, I think I might have told you about this back in the day, but a few days ago, but a hero that is focused on Prince and Princess.
Oh, yeah.
So we got two things coming that should help it. And, great for the game, yeah.
We also have a six-cost character that at some point that's also going to
help. Oh, yes. And that's great for us, right? We want to have more variety in the late game. And Prince and Princess is one that's just been coming up short. It's just going to be a healthier game if we can get that to be part of the
big. I'm interested in what you're going to do to Prince Arthur, because that is certainly one that I'd say about 30% of my games now I go Prince Princess because of this
the challenge
brain bug you put in my head. But
you're not going to want to do that anymore. They're going to be too good. They're not going to be hipster.
Yeah, well, that's true. But I've noticed that it's really hard for me to get Prince Arthur. Right, it's like I assume that people are drafting him because he's obviously so good in Prince and Princess that when I'm doing that, it's a big boost. So anyway.
Well, he's going to get even more drafted. He's
I got to get out of town.
He's going down to level 3. So it's going to be crazy.
That is a big change.
Yeah.
That's a big change.
Peter
Pan, don't need
Peter Pan,
Oh, Peter Pan will love him. Yeah. That actually is my favorite hero, is probably Peter Pan.
Okay,
Peter
nice.
Pan is amazing.
Awesome. Yeah. Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah. So Richard, it truly warms our hearts that you love the game, right? Our lives being just so dramatic. It's unimaginable what our lives would be at without, you know, magic, right? Our lives have been set on that path since we started playing the game, some of us at 11, some of us at 18. But yeah, so thank you so much for doing this with us. It's awesome that you like the game. And yeah, this is great. We look forward to chatting with you in the future.
Well, thanks for providing all this fun. It's a lot of fun to see what you can do with this genre.
It's awesome. But a small percentage of how much fun you've given us over the years. So yeah. Really, we're both very appreciative of
it. We owe you. About 25 years. Yeah. Awesome. All right. Thank you. Great chatting.
Yeah, my pleasure.
All right.